My sincere appreciation to all of you for coming out and attending what I believe will be the youngest ever presentation or youngest ever panel presentation in Sportaccord history. And the material that's going to be presented today will be the first time that this information has been shared with the public. So my thanks to all of you for being here and being a part of this. Again, as I always do with my kind of standard housekeeping, we'll ask you to turn off your phones or set them to vibrate. We continue to thank our sponsors, and I won't name them because you've heard me do that before, but we'll recognize them at least visually so that you know that we do appreciate all that they do for Sportaccord. And on the weather front, I'm going to continue to urge each of you to be cautious or considerate about the conditions outside relative to your travel plans. The storm is intensifying. I'm hearing that more airlines are shutting down. We heard earlier from Rob Cohen that there may have only been 140 people planning to fly out today. But my recommendation to you is that tomorrow morning, all the flights that canceled today will create mayhem out at the airport in the morning. And if you had a flight tomorrow morning, I would expect that you should be prepared for change. So we'll urge you to be thoughtful about that just so that you have time to be prepared and to rectify that. The next presentation that's going to take place is, I think, something that is so integral to how the IOC sees the future of the Olympics. And I'm saying that without being an IOC representative, but just as kind of a member of our family, which is that the youth games and the importance of youth cannot be underestimated, and it can't be overlooked. And to that end, I think the IOC has made a great decision, and again, this is my opinion, and I'm not asked to have an opinion, that the youth of the world are important to how the games and how our federations go forward. So it's my great pleasure to introduce to you the former CEO of the 2003 Paris World Championships, the COO of the Paris bid for 2012, and now the head of the Youth Olympic Games for the IOC, Essar Gabriel, to take you through a case study on the Youth Olympic Games. Essar, thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here and to look at this subject of the Youth Olympic Games. Indeed, it's the first time that we will be sharing and having the IOC share with us its vision of the Youth Olympic Games to the larger public that you are. Allow me to introduce our guest today, which will form a great panel, one of the youngest one, indeed the youngest one probably in the history of Sportaccord presentations and conferences, but also I guess a panel which will be there to engage with you and look to discuss about this new project called the Youth Olympic Game and the YOG, as we call it. The first member of our panel today is Gilbert Feli. I will ask him to come up, and I'd like a round of applause for him. Gilbert Feli is the executive director of the Olympic Games at the International Olympic Committee. He is my boss. He overlooks all the Olympic Games, the Youth Olympic Games today, but also, as a lot of you know, the Olympic Games in general, and he has a wealth of knowledge and a depth of knowledge which is unequaled in the world of organizing multi-sporting events. The second guest is our first champion. She is currently the world champion for swimming, 100-meter freestyle. She's 17-year-old. She comes from Texas. Allow me to introduce Samantha Tucker. Our third guest is an IOC member. He is today a member of the executive board. He has presided the organizing committee of the 117th session in Singapore in 2005, which saw Paris, as you know, have London breach and get to honor and organize the games in 2012. Sermyong is today the chairman of the Singapore Youth Olympic Games Organizing Committees. Sermyong Enger. Our second top athlete or should I say was a former top athlete, spent 10 years on competitive figure skating. He is today really into competitive dance training and wants to make it into the entertainment business. He's already started to. He's described as having a great sense of humor and dedication to excellence. Well, Eric, you're on board, and I hope you will make this interesting for the US Olympic Games. Let's welcome Eric Kayser. One of the all-time greats of track and field on the 100 meter and the 200 meter, today an IOC member, he is the chairman of the IOC Athletes Commission. It's a great pleasure and an honor to call Frankie Fredericks. And finally, so that we do have insights and have a look at what the youth today are about and looking forward beyond the Youth Olympic Games and discussing, I hope, what will be an enriching experience about youth at large, we have with us the Director of the Global Clients and Business Development of the United Group, which is part of WPP, and that is Daniel Wadia. Today's the panel that the way we're going to go through this panel is, first of all, I'll be asking Daniel to come over and to present in 15 minutes his insights and those of his organization about youth trends. By and large, today, I think we are all interested by such insights as the youth are of today are those who will be the champions, but also the spectators and those engaging into sports in the next coming years. After this 15-minute presentation, Gilbert Felly will be presenting in an extensive manner the Youth Olympic Games, and that will float from the vision and the objectives and to what the Youth Olympic Games are about today. And I think very importantly, looking at how is the IOC looking to engage with the youth of the world by and large, and this is a challenge that we are all facing. After those two presentations, well, the floor will be open. I will be moderating the session, but this is then yours to discuss and to have the round table with our great panel, which is here assembled. So, without any further notice, I will be calling on Daniel to come here and let us take us through the trends and what you see in your crystal ball. Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So, I think the first thing I'd like to say is youth culture is a very broad, very complex subject. And in the next 10 to 15 minutes, I'm really going to try and just touch on a few key trends that the advertising agency I work for has uncovered over the years as we've been exploring this young audience and finding ways to connect with them through the brands that we represent. We've been working with the IOC now for over 2 years. We're responsible for the Best of Us campaign that some of you may be familiar with. And we're also going to be working with Isel Gilbert Filly and the team, the YOG team, to develop a communications and creative campaign to engage young people with a specific focus on YOG. So again, I hate to sort of make generalizations about young people when in fact they're an incredibly rich, dynamic, and somewhat complicated audience to reach. But hopefully, if nothing else, in the next 10 minutes, you'll be exposed to a few trends that will hopefully shed some light without getting into too much depth, which would need a much longer discussion. So moving to the next slide, please. The five trends that I'm going to cover are what we call connectivity, or the Weevolution, driven to action, creativity and customization, authenticity, and diversity. On a slide like this, those words probably mean nothing, so we can move to the next one, where I'm going to really speak about what we mean by connectivity and the Weevolution. The first thing with this young audience is that they are more group and we-focused than any other generation in the past. And the primary reason for this is that the abundance of digital media, social networking sites that have really been able to propagate their ability to create wide-ranging communities that they were never able to create before. In the past, they might have created a community at their school or with their sports club, but the internet has really enabled them to create much wider communities. I think a dichotomy that we found very interesting with young people is that they're both highly individualistic. If you think about a MySpace page or a Facebook page, it really is the equivalent of a diary I may have written when I was 14 years old and that I decided to post to 500 of my friends around the world. So their individualism, their need to promote themselves, is very much in existence. But interestingly, it's sort of juxtaposed with this collective dimension, this need to belong to something, or in their case now, to many things. And really, this trend that I'm describing has ushered the explosion of just a few projects that I cite here, such as Threadless, which is where you can design your own t-shirts online, and then people can vote on who has the best t-shirt. And it's a massive trend going on right now. As we know, fashion in itself is an important part of young people's lives, but also Wikipedia and things like My Football Club, not to mention the fantasy sports sites that are in huge abundance, which also help to create communities. Moving to the next slide. The second one, and I think I'm sure you're all very aware of this, I'm not saying anything new, but they really are driven to action. They have a strong sense of social responsibility and an eagerness to make a difference. And it's not that this generation is more altruistic than previous generations. It's the fact that they've been exposed, and they continue to be exposed, to so much more information and news that is out there, which means that they expect a lot more from the brands, the corporations, the sporting federations that they come across and that they engage with. And there's a statistics there saying that they expect the same from corporations, as 69% of young people believe brands can make a bigger difference in the world than politicians can. This was looking at 12 to 19-year-olds, if any of you were curious about how I'm defining youth today. And they seek out brands that are focused on making a difference, as evidenced by 53% of 14 to 34-year-olds who bought a product that donated money to a cause project, like Three Dots Cash, Innocent Drinks, and Tokyo's Eco Bag, being some strong examples. Again, very few examples among very many. So we think that sports, in this particular trend, play a big part, because I think, you know, sport and social responsibility can go hand in hand. And you know, I was very interested, as I'm sure a lot of you were, to be part of the audience when the Andre Agassi and that panel were discussing this particular subject yesterday. Next is creativity and customization. Now, I don't want to say that this is a more creative generation than previous generations, but how they express their creativity has certainly evolved in ways that are unparalleled. This audience now has the ability to manipulate anything that is out there. They can take a film, such as Star Wars, take a 15-second segment and do what's called a mashup, use the elements that are within it and tailor it to something that they think is interesting to themselves or to their friends. So their ability to create and co-create with brands and organizations is something that we urge all of our clients, including the IOC, to embrace and not to be scared of. And the reason I say this is we have found in the past some of our clients do get scared by this phenomenon, this ability that they have to do user-generated content, to manipulate creative elements that they've found elsewhere, because it means that your brand is losing a certain amount of control. The reality is that they're going to do this anyway, so it's better to invite them in and participate with them and encourage them to be creative rather than to try and control what it is that they are doing out there. It still needs to be done within reason. Every brand out there needs to protect itself. But if you try and be too defensive, these kids are going to be all over you in a heartbeat. Next one, please. Authenticity. I think more than ever, they are craving, as it says on this slide, something real, real stories, real people, real brands. They're much more skeptical than I think audiences were in the past. If you think about when most of you were growing up, you know, you were passive audiences in the advertising or the communications that was projected at you. There wasn't really much for you to discuss or to rebel against. You were passive audiences. This is an active audience, and the more real you can be with them, the more they're going to embrace you, your federation, your brands, or whatever it is that you're trying to communicate with them. And the second point here says that the simplest way to do this is to know the world they live in and make a viable attempt to live in it. And it seems so simple when it's written in this way, but it's incredibly difficult. That this audience is constantly changing, they're constantly evolving. To stay on top of the new trends, even for us in our industry where we specialize in this, we frankly have difficulties with it. And I think we're at the forefront of it, but they're still changing before we're able to keep up with them. So it's very difficult, but what we call cultural anthropology is really the ability to understand youth culture, impregnate yourself into youth culture in order to generate a lot of trends and help inform some of the creative and campaign decisions that we then make and suggest to our clients. Push in. Diversity, I think this is one of the key sort of shifts right now, which is the way in which young people distinguish themselves from each other has less to do with the traditional boundaries, such as what country you're from or race or your religion. And there's a lot more of a focus on lifestyle differences. So a simple example of this is a 14-year-old in Tokyo might have more in common, who's into hip-hop and a certain type of fashion, might have more in common with a 14-year-old in New York who's into the same lifestyle trends than that 14-year-old in Tokyo may have with somebody else of his age group that's in his classroom. So the boundaries of how young people are relating to each other are dramatically changing around lifestyle, which is a great opportunity for anybody trying to reach out to a global audience. You can really find those lifestyle trends that are relevant to them and tap into those and find the ones where there's some common ground, as opposed to worrying about the differences between the different cultures. This is not to say that cultural differences no longer exist and it's all about lifestyle. I'm not trying to be categorical. This isn't black or white, but I am trying to say that there is a radical shift towards lifestyles. Next slide, please. So just summing up, these were the five trends that that I discussed. Again, this is very top line. I don't mean to diminish this incredibly inspiring and incredibly rich audience into just five buckets, but I thought it would be interesting, hopefully, to give a little bit of a taste of some of the trends that we've been exploring as part of a much bigger research study. And this sentence at the bottom, I think, is very true, which is that this is a generation with a calling, it's one that craves a challenge, and it's one that wants to be remembered. And the role that sports in their lives and that, you know, sports federations and the IOC can play in inspiring and engaging young people is without parallel in our opinion. And I've worked for several brands and engaged with young people such as, you know, Coca-Cola, or Nike, but that there is nothing like either the Olympic movement or sports in general, the practicing of sports, that can have as much of a powerful impact on them as anything that a commercial brand is capable of achieving. There is one challenge I would like to speak to, which is the fact that they are kind of over-media, they're over-hyped, they're overexposed. They're exposed to so much information out there, and a lot of it isn't good information or accurate information. So the negative side of their curiosity is the fact that more does not necessarily translate into better, and especially if you consider the editorial and opinionated nature of this audience. What I mean by that is that this audience is also one that's capable, as I think I mentioned before, of expressing itself if it's dissatisfied with something, or if it is, on the other hand, satisfied with what is going on out there. So the fact that they have a voice is something that we want to embrace, but you know, with that can come certain complications, and specifically with sport, moving to the next slide, they can't escape a certain amount of negativity and skepticism that can at times surround sport. They're exposed to the wonders of sport as much as they are to the negative. And they have grown up, and in our research and speaking to them, in an era where sport, unfortunately, has been linked to controversy, descriptors that you're familiar with, such as, you know, steroids, cheating, and crime, are arguably as prominent, not in their minds, but in the media, in what they're fed, in what they're exposed to, as victory, celebration, and, you know, being an athlete, the joys of being an athlete. So I don't want to end my short talk on a negative note, because I don't want to say that the negativity and the skepticism is something that we all need to be incredibly concerned about. But if we move to the next slide, I do think that there is a role that we all have in tackling this head on. And I think if our focus, and when I say our, I mean this collectively, is on cultivating and harnessing the passion, the firepower that drives the beauty and magic of sports for young people, and if we are successful in listening to them, and I can't emphasize enough the importance of listening to young people and engaging with them, they'll actually become ours and your biggest allies in correcting any negative information that can be down to an individual sport or a sports authority or whatever it may be. They will take it upon themselves to correct that information, not because they want to please you, but they will be defending themselves. And I think it's very important for us to understand that they have a great power for forgiveness if somebody or someone or an organization in any way has made a mistake or said something wrong. You just need to listen to them, engage with them, bring them into that conversation, and they will become what we sort of call, and this is marketing speak, but we call them brand evangelists. You know, they are a medium in themselves. Forget TV or print advertising or even digital advertising. There is nothing like a young person telling another young person something powerful about your brand or about your movement. So with that, I'd like to thank you very much. And there's a much more interesting presentation about to happen on the yog itself. So without further ado, Gilbert Filly.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel. I guess while Gilbert is going up to the desk, this notion of engagement and interacting with the youth starts with understanding what they are about. And I guess Samantha and Eric, after Gilbert's presentation, you will be able to share with us and be part of this discussion. And I hope you will prove him right. Gilbert, the Youth Olympic Games, all yours for this first at Sportaccord.
Good afternoon. Before I will start my presentation, maybe I would like to make four remarks. The first one, I'll be sorry because it will be a little long. I've been asked to explain the Youth Olympic Games altogether because many people don't understand what it is exactly. So it take me a bit of time. The second thing I'm a bit afraid of, because Daniel said it's difficult. I knew it was difficult, but you're telling us it's even more difficult to reach the youth, so it's going to be a challenge. The third one is for USR. You made a big mistake, because before, when you introduced myself, you said my boss, and I don't think it's the language the young people like to listen to. You could at least say my older brother or something else. And fourth, for me, I can tell you, all of you, we started this project in Guatemala in 2007, 2 years ago, a bit less. And since my mind and my brain went 20 years younger, unfortunately, my body didn't follow, and I'm remaining at the same level with my body. So to speak about the Youth Olympic Games, I think I will talk to you today about the vision, the mission, of the objective of the IOC. I will, in the second phase, explain to you the description of the project based on the sport competition, the culture, and the education program. And third, to try to explain to you how we intend to reach the youth. And there it will join a little bit what Daniel has been telling you. The context that we are talking about in Guatemala, the context is that the IOC realized that, of course, it's one of our tasks is to do something for the youth in the sport. And we realized that by through different analysis that we had an unequal access to sport for the youth. We had a decline in physical activities and increase of obesities and drop in sport participation in the 11-14-year-old. So it is something that we said, what can we do? And one of the answers to that was that, of course, we could do many things. The many things are, of course, trying maybe to modernize a little bit of our Olympic program with introducing activities more links to the youth, like the BMX or the ski cross or the snowboard cross, promoting the value of the youth through our campaign Best of Us, go through changing our digital media organization of our Olympic org, and of course in our project education value program. And maybe we could introduce a new product for the youth called the Youth Olympic Game. So our vision there was to organize the game. We believe that the Youth Olympic Game will inspire the young people around the world to participate in sport and adopt a life by Olympic values. So sport and Olympic values were the main objective of our vision. If I go to the mission that the IOC session gave to the IOC Executive Board and the administration, is to say that we need to organize and even to educate, engage, and influence the young people, inspiring them to play an active role in their community. So we want the kids to come to an event and go back home and be able to give something back to their community. So what are the Youth Olympic Games? The definition of the Youth Olympic are a sporting event, because we want to be a sporting event and we want to have the best athlete to compete there, but balancing sport, education, and culture. And it should also be, inside the Olympic movement, a catalyst for sporting, education, culture, other activities that the IOC and the Olympic movement has. So what were our objectives? We tried to come out with 8 objectives that we have got for those Youth Olympic Games. As I said before, and you will see in point 1 and in point 8, that there are really links to the sport and the performance of the athletes and the quality of the athletes, because we want to bring together and celebrate the best young athletes of the age group. And the second, we propose a unique and powerful introduction to Olympism, because we believe that it's one of our tasks and maybe we are not doing enough there. Innovate in education and debating Olympic value in society. We believe that it's our task and our duty to give a platform to the youth who are coming to our competition to be able to say something. Too many times the athletes are coming, they have to perform, and we just say, more or less, shut up. So we want them to speak about it and want them to tell us what do they believe about our values that we are telling them, blah, 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 but maybe they've got different view about it. And also about all the societal challenges that we have got. Share and celebrate the culture of the world in a festive atmosphere. We want those games to be festive. At the time that the kids are coming to the airport or the railway station until the day they leave, we want them to be happy and have fun. Reach the youth community through the world to promote Olympic value. And this is a difficult one that I'm going to speak about at the end of the presentation, but it's the challenge for us that we don't reach only the kids who are coming, because at the end it's only 3,500 kids, you will see later, but we want to reach the world and we want to reach the kids. Raise the sport awareness and participation among the youth. Act as a platform for initiative within the Olympic movement. And again, at the end, organize an event of the highest sport international standards. That is for the organizers. That is not a festival, but it's a sport competition, and it's a competition that's a new product that we have got. If I go to the description of the product and of the games, we have 2 parts. As I said before, for us, we give the same weight, the equal weight, to the sport competition, culture, and education, and what we believe should be those games. So if I go to the first, the sport competition. The sport competition, the event will be every 4 years. The first one will be in Singapore in 2010, and then Innsbruck for the winter will be in 2012. So it's every 2nd year where we'll have a possibility to reach the youth through the game. The competition, the duration of the competition is going to be 12 days for the summer and 10 days for the winter. We don't pretend that if you want to organize the Olympic Games, you have to build new venues. Of course, it's not forbidden, but we'll try to say, okay, try to use the facilities. And this is why you will see later that the capacities of the venues are often very small, and this is a vision for us to use facilities that are existing. And also, on the service level, I will not elaborate too much, but we try to have service levels that are completely different that we have got for the Olympic game. However, this is not easy with our partners. Sometimes they have got the games in the head and sometimes difficult to change the mind of the people. What does the IOC want to do and support him in the principle? The IOC said we want to do something for the youth, so we need to invest. So we will finance the travel and the stay of the NOC delegation, the athletes, the coaches, and the others. The same for the IF representatives, that means the judges, referees that are needed. And also we propose to, on our cost, present a daily highlight of the game. Of course, we are working with organizing committee. If we can do more to do some live television and some of the events, that we will do with our organizing committee. But that's the basic promises that we have done. On a structure of marketing, of course, we need, as this is an event of the IOC, we need to protect our top program, top sponsor program. And we also try to propose to them some specific signature properties in a way that maybe they could find ways to support those games. And we will keep the clean venue policy that you have got in the Olympic Games. It's going to be no billboard and no publicity on the venues. The participation of that, it's participation goes for the athletes between 14 and 18. So you must be 14 and you should not be older than 18, but we give for each sports 2 years difference inside the discipline. And then for every events, for every time, we give exactly the date of which date the athletes can participate. 3,500 athletes, 1,100 officials for the summer, 1,100 athletes for the winter, and 800 officials. And we have got there some new participants that we want to really be part of this project, so the non-athlete youth participation. We will encourage, and we have some program for young reporters, so we are working with a certain number of NOCs where those athletes will be reporting, those young kids, in their country through the different media that exist and speak to the young people. We will have some so-called ambassadors. We probably will change the name because we believe it's not very young and not very youth to say that, but they are young chef de mission, young part of the delegation. This person will be more in charge to speak about the youth game before they come and also try to support the kids through the educational program. And then, of course, we are working on the sports to make sure that we have got universality, that the kids can come at the game. We will have at least 4 participants for each National Olympic Committee. The detail of the program, we are saying that the kids have to stay for the full duration of the game. So we don't want athletes to come to compete and to leave. We want them to stay in the village so they can participate to all the educational and cultural program. So we will work with the international federations on the program that we propose, and then also the daily program that we have got. What we have got at the game is that we have got the same sport that we will have at the Olympic game, but not automatically with the same events or discipline. And the cultural program, we want it to be interactive and innovative, and there is a challenge for us because we have got some knowledge on sport. We don't have much knowledge in education at the IOC. And then, of course, the idea is to create communities of ambassadors through the world, as I said at the beginning. So those kids are going to go back to be our ambassador, the ambassador not of the IOC, but the ambassador of the Olympic values. The sport program, we can say that in most of the cases, we had difficulty. We have to be frank with International Federation because there are a lot of conservatives, and they see it as a platform for the future game of the player of sports to have some sports who are some discipline or events who are completely different. We have got 3 where we have been able to manage in basketball, where it will be 3 versus 3. In the canoe, we will have a head-to-head between slalom and sprint. And in cycling, where it's a kind of team competition between the different disciplines of cycling. We also have tried with some other sports to have some new ideas. In the individual competition, it will be always the representative of the NOCs. But we have tried to have, in some cases, you see here some examples that mix gender, boys and girls in some of the competitions, and also sometimes mix NOCs on the team competition where you have got kids from different NOCs who will compete together in some of the events. The level, the quality of the competition should be junior level. We have decided not to have any record register, and we have got difficulty there because people always say, ah, yeah, but if they do well, yeah, but it's a question of philosophy for us. It's not a question of sport performance, so we have decided not to have it. But I have to tell you, with some federation, it's difficult because the philosophy is not here yet. And as I said before, the stadium, small capacity between 500 and 10,000 seats. The principle for the qualification system, individual sport, as I said, we'll have four places attributed to each NOC. So now we have been telling 112 national Olympic committees, they are the ones who are sending small delegation at the Olympic game, almost through the wildcard system, with 10 or 12 have less at the game. You can have four. So we started in January. We offer these four places, and they have got until the end of this month to come back to us and said, we would like to compete in this sport, this sport, this sport, this sport, with a priority list. We will have a commission to award it the position. And then after, we will go to the qualification system for the 93 left NOCs, the strong NOCs. And a delegation cannot be more than 70 NOCs, 70 athletes by NOC. And in team sport, we will have six teams in each competitions, but with a maximum of two teams, one girl, one man, NOC. If I go to the educational program, as I said before, we are not experts, so we have the IOC president that put a group together, a group of experts, and I'm happy to see Gundrud here sitting in the room, and maybe some others who are part of this expert group, who are experts in education, to help us to put the program together. The program, we believe, and it's less we could say, that it will be attractive, to be participative, and it's not exactly the case now because I'm speaking by myself, interactive, fun, instead for the kids, innovative, flexible, and that's important, and we'll come back to that later, and adapted to the youth of this age. This is a challenge, of course, but we try to have a large audience for this educational program. As I said before, the athletes participating at the game, the non-athlete participant, and the local athletes also, because we'll take advantage in Singapore, but in the other, to mix also the kids of the country with the kids who are participating there. With the intention, of course, to also be interacting with the youth community worldwide, but we also want to reach the coaches, the parents, and the educators, and we have been told by everybody that the coaches are the worst one, and the parents also are the worst people to have the kids to try to be educated, but they want the kids only to perform on the sport. So we will have a big challenge with the coaches and the parents coming to this Youth Olympic game. But we know it, and we are going to work into it. I will not go into details, but there are some teams that we are still working on it, but which way we like to have the kids to be, get close to it, the historic Olympic movement, the doping, the well-being, the career of the athletes, social responsibility, community assistance, all these aspects there, we like to be able, the kids to be aware of it and to be able to debate about it. The program will start, of course, we will have the program in different phases, pre-game, Olympic game, and the post-game. So what we will do in the pre-game is to try to, of course, get the people and to be in the awareness and inform and engage the federations. That's where, Antoine, if you could change, where we will be. The most difficult task is to try to go and get the NOCs, mainly the first one, but National Federation, but also Olympians and others, to speak about the game and try to engage the people. Lead and coordinate youth-related initiative involving all parties and allow IOC and YOCOG Organizing Committee to reach different networks. As this is before the game. During the game, we will conceive around the sport program. We are working, and Singapore is doing a great job with that, to try to understand when the kids will have free time in each of the sport. And we are working with International Federation to make sure we can do that. We want also to have most of the program built inside the Olympic Village, so we have got the kids, if they have got just half an hour free, they don't know what to do, they could come and participate. We want to have the program not to be an obligation, but to be à la carte, system to allow flexibility. It will be a compromise between culture and education. Participation, we have said we want the kids to stay all the games because we won't be able to get those kids to educate them and give they go back home with what is our vision. And we will involve athlete role models, not former, but Olympic champion, because you remain Olympic champion all your life, and then also from different world championship athletes who can come and speak to the younger generations. The program is based really on what is an educational program on the UNESCO system, where, of course, we will learn to know, so the education session, where we'll give educations, learn to do education activities, where they can do things themselves, learn to be an educational forum, in which one they can debate between themselves, and finally, learn to be together. It's more on the cultural side where the kids can be together and reach different cultures. After the game, it will be important that the kids go back home with some information. We will also work with the NOCs and IF to compilation of best practice for them sport or for their educations. And of course, we will go to a transfer of knowledge because, as I said, for us, it's new and we don't know where we are, so we'll have to adapt our transfer of knowledge. So this is the educational program. We will have, of course, the games, as I said, in Singapore, and I will come back to Singapore after, but I go first to Innsbruck. That's the last game that I've been awarded, and we just have a little movie to show how Innsbruck already understood in the bidding process how they could reach a little bit the youth and combine the sport and youth, and if we could just have the video presented by Innsbruck during the bid process. So it shows already that the organizing committee have got ideas about it. We have on our side, and you have on your seat, a CD-ROM where you can find what I've been saying now and also a little video on our side. The next step for us, that's the key, and I think that's where we will succeed or not succeed, is really engaging the youth of the world. And there, we still have to work, because if we see where we are today since Guatemala a year and a half ago, a little bit more, in Guatemala we have defined visions. And I repeat again to you, the vision was to the Youth Olympic Games will inspire young people around the world to participate in sport and adopt lifestyle values. The second thing, we have to put the concept in place, and then we have a sport program so we can communicate about it, and we have got not finalized, but already good culture and education program, so we can speak about it. Then we have been going to the product. We have been able to put in place a structure of bidding process, evaluation, and awarding the games, plus go to the education and all the technical aspect of the game with Singapore Innsbruck, and we are in the bidding process for 2014. Of course, now the big one is the engagement. And there we feel that we have been starting to work, and we've been talking, and Daniel was speaking about it, how to reach the youth. There we need to have some objective, of course, engage the youth of the world. It's easy to say, a bit more complicated to do, I guess. The concept, the event is not only an event, but it's something more, and that's where we really need to understand that it should not be a mini game, but it should be something new, where we want to have something more than the sport event. Success engagement beyond of the events, even a success is not enough, so we cannot just have a good organizer to organize a good event, but we need to have a good product at the end. So what we are going to do beyond the participation, of course, is the involvement of non-sporting youth, not only the ones who are in the sport, but try to reach the kids who are not in the sport, away from a given edition elsewhere. So we want to do not something during the games, but between the games. So continually on our relation with the youth, we should be present. And of course, as I said, it should be sustainable. So what are we doing? A lot of work still. Apparently, but we, first of all, the IOC on its side have revamped its Olympic.org into a Web 2.0, and this will be launched during the summer of this year. And of course, we're also working to try to engage ourselves through young communities. And Singapore has been doing already a lot of work. Singapore, I can tell you that it's a good organizing committee because I understand that they've been reaching already the local youth through some website and the ways I've been reaching them. We just let you understand through a spot of the new website of Singapore on the youth and one of the parts that they have done, and I will let SR go through this presentation. It goes by itself, okay.
Yeah, you heard me right. We're looking for a whole new bunch of sports presenters because we feel that the Youth Olympic Games should be presented by the youth of Singapore, and that is you. Look, it doesn't matter if you look like this. It doesn't matter if you look like this. All you have to do is to sign up right now. Register today, and you will be in the course. We're conducting a camp all of December, a two-day camp, and you will be inside of it. Who knows? You could be the next generation of sportscasters, not just for the Youth Olympics, but for all of Singapore that we so desperately need. So register right now. Places are limited. Closing date, 8th of December. We will see you here. Be the face of the Youth Olympics. All you have to do is to click on right now, www.singapore2010.sg. You heard me right, www.singapore2010.sg. More information is right there in the palm of your hands.
So thank you. And SR, I'll let you the floor to comment on this video and to animate the debate. Thank you.
Well, a big round of applause for Gilbert Felly.